Situation for Americans to be in, that you're legally prohibited from seeking out a cure for your disease. I'm going to try to keep my passion down a little bit here, but it's sometimes it gets away from me. We see situations where kids die because they don't have the proper treatment. Obviously, we see adults with advanced cancers. I know people that the cancers have been treated and they are in remission to this day. But you also know, all of us know people that have passed from cancer. Eliminating cannabis as an option, to me, that's critical. And for those of us that are helping with the petition feel the same way. And we're seeing this research not just beginning to come out, but it's been coming out. And the miracles associated with cannabis are way too many and way too positive for us to keep treating it the way we have been in this county. So that's why I'm here, that's why those that are here helping us with this effort. We have got to change the scenario. And if we do that here in Missouri, the way that we have in front of us, I'm telling you, the only thing to fear is the fear itself. There's nothing to fear from a level of freedom when it comes to cannabis. And really all we're going to see is better cures, better medicines, a lot more industry, and a lot less expenditure on our justice system. I think all of those are good things. Now, I didn't come here tonight to just expound and rant and have you all listen to me. There's a very important gentleman here this evening that I'm proud to introduce and call friend. I've known Mark Pedersen for several years. He is the author of the Missouri Cannabis Restoration Protection Act that we're going to be talking about this evening. He is also an educator in the field of cannabis. As far as speaking engagements all over the country, lots of different educational institutions, Mark has become a national expert. Over and above that, he is personally involved with actually administrating some cannabis products to patients in other states and seeing tremendous results, seeing kids that, well, now they're children again instead of patients. It's just been beautiful, some of the stories that he has to say, and he'll be sharing that with us a little later. Mark's the co-founder. I'll get out my notes here. He's the co-founder of the Cannabis Patient Network Institute and director of the ECS Therapy Center. And here's a quote that we had in our press release. I think it's good, and I'll go ahead and put it out here. This is Mark, and he says, "I want to introduce Missourians to real people who benefit from cannabis. Our refugee children are miracles that need to be shared with the world." And I agree. It's once you hear these stories and you see these videos, it gives you the kind of attitude like I've got right now. It's just horrendous that we're keeping medicines from these kids and adults. Having said that, I do want to just give a little bit more background of the historical efforts here in Springfield. Not too long ago, a group of citizens got together and we petitioned to have marijuana decriminalized in the city. I actually sat on the city council that voted to not respect that petition and to kick it to the curb. Well, the citizens sued the city council, and we ended up settling out of court. That's where that left, and the laws remain the same. It was, I thought it was a real violation of the will of the people. And so now here we are, round two. We just can't let that set. And now we're going to go ahead and see what we can do about getting this done statewide. And once we get a certified number of signatures to put this on the ballot, only an act of God could keep it off the ballot. There ain't going to be no city council that pulls some little strings and keeps this from happening. Like I said before, we're the Springfield Cannabis Restoration Community. We're a conglomeration of groups and individuals. The beautiful part that I'm seeing about this is the folks that are involved. You know, I'm seeing Democrats get involved. I'm seeing Republicans get involved. I'm seeing a lot of independents get involved. It really kind of crosses the partisan politics here and allows us to kind of unite together with people that we normally want to bicker with. I think that's a good thing. We've received some criticism already from perhaps some of the groups that should be helping us out. Anytime you try to do something productive, you're going to get that criticism. I want to just address some of it real quickly here. There's the issue with, we don't have age limits on this. You want kids to smoke pot. Well, to those critics, I say the laws that we have on the books right now makes it a lot more easier for our kids to smoke pot. There's not a school in this country that doesn't have pot in it because of our prohibitionary laws. If you're a kid and you're a drug dealer, you suffer a lot less penalties than adults. So that's where the black market seems to concentrate. That's why drugs get pushed into our schools. Another criticism as well, you're going to allow people to get out of DUIs if they are caught driving while under the influence of cannabis. All right, point taken. Do people get DUIs for driving under the influence of Ritalin? Do people get DUIs under the influence of other medicines that they take? That's kind of our point. This is a medicine. It's non-toxic. And it does not have the same effect as alcohol. So when we're addressing these types of criticisms, I realize a lot of where that is coming from is, well, it isn't our measure, so we need to criticize yours. Well, that's fine and dandy. I just hope people act honorably moving forward, and that if we agree to disagree, we agree to disagree. But this is too important for us to spend a lot of time bickering about. We are going to move forward and get these signatures and get this on the ballot. And I'm confident that if we can make that happen, voters in Missouri will respond in kind and pass this. I have no doubt about that. At this point, I feel like I've talked enough. Y'all are tired of listening to me. I can't blame you. Let me introduce Mark Pedersen. And Mark, if you would come on up. Let's welcome you.
Hello, everybody. My meetings are pretty informal, so, you know, just so you all know. I'm not a professional speaker, though it seems like I keep getting thrust in positions where I end up doing it, so whatever it's going to take. Again, my name is Mark Pedersen, and I'm founder and director of the ECS Therapy Centers, our national 501c focused on cannabis patient education, and CPN Institute, our benevolence organization. I was 56 years a Missourian before moving to Colorado. I'm 58 now. I grew up in a small, very polluted little town, Herculaneum, Missouri. That's actually what made me. You see, the principal industry there was lead smoke. The carcinogens were everywhere, outside and inside our homes. You couldn't get away from it, from the plumes billowing from the massive smokestack to the dust that poured from the dump trucks that rolled up and down my street. Being leaded was a normal occurrence long before we realized what it was doing to us. As a certified welder and pipe fitter, I worked in power plants. I also had a small computer consulting business and a benevolence ministry, food pantry related services. We helped people with food, their bills. I also did a lot of hospital visitation. I regularly worked 80 plus hours a week. While remodeling my home, I was exposed to heavy levels of lead, cadmium, and arsenic, the byproducts of the lead smelting industry. 85 years of contamination released from pulled up carpet and open walls. I became quite ill. I suffered migraines, seizures, fibromyalgia pain, neuropathy in my hands and feet. I couldn't do the things I cared most about anymore. I could no longer provide for my family. My exposure stripped me of my profession, my ministry, my life, ultimately my family and my health. It was back in 1997 when I discovered a small blip in a fibromyalgia news group that stated that cannabis could be effective in treating fibromyalgia pain. I had already been receptive of virtually every drug the doctors could throw at me. I figured what could it hurt? Nothing else was working. So after a few months of using a very poor quality cannabis from a friend, I discovered that it not only helped with the pain, remarkably well too, it also took away the migraines that even experimental drugs could not touch. The seizures, the neuropathy of my hands and feet, the fibromyalgia, but perhaps the most profound for me was restoring my long-term memories. Priceless memories like the birth of my three children. Why did I have such a profound benefit? As it turns out, all mammals are born with what is called an endocannabinoid system. This is, in simple terms, a lipid messaging system. When we consume plant-based or phytocannabinoids, they're similar enough to the endogenous components, the endocannabinoids, to perform as a supplement. They fit the endogenous receptors found throughout the body, much like a skeleton key. What we know of the endocannabinoid system is that it maintains and regulates all of the primary systems of the body, homeostasis being the objective. Recent research suggests that it may well be our primary endocrine system. If this is the case, it's vital for all of us to have access to cannabis. When a cancerous tumor develops, very quickly endocannabinoid receptors appear about the tumor and engage the cells in apoptosis, or cell death. One of the attributes of the endocannabinoid system is its ability to isolate and terminate tumors. The health of this endogenous system really determines whether or not the tumor is allowed to remain. My partner, Regina Nelson, her daughter, Brianna, came from Michigan to live with us. She was 26 years old and the mother of a three-year-old with special needs. Prior to the move, she was diagnosed with stomach cancer. Michigan surgeons urged the immediate removal of most of her stomach. Instead, she traveled to our home in Colorado Springs and began taking cannabis oil that I prepared for her, along with drinking raw cannabis juice, a non-psychoactive superfood that allows phytocannabinoids to boost the immune system very rapidly. Within weeks of arriving at our home, she was rushed to the emergency room, where they discovered that the tumor had broken free and was hanging by a small band of tissue. Needless to say, the emergency room doctors had no idea how to proceed. Brianna returned to our home and later passed the tumor. That's called apoptosis. She is currently cancer-free. I began making cannabis oil primarily so I could teach others how to do so. I knew the miracles that surrounded cannabis oil. I followed a Missouri man, Brian Chitwood, for 3 years as he battled terminal melanoma. I'm sorry, excuse me, let me jump back. When we first met, he was recovering from Hodgkin's lymphoma. The chemotherapy he received for Hodgkin's caused the second cancer, the melanoma. As you're going to see in the next slide, which I'm sorry I advanced that too quickly, you're going to see actual pictures of the very tumors. Barnes Hospital, sorry people, if this is difficult to look at, please look away. Barnes Hospital in St. Louis took biopsies of the whole reason. This is actually his right hip. The black lesions are indeed melanoma, but the white lesions are curiously something else, as Barnes Hospital found out. They mutated and are now dying. Melanoma is not an easy thing to look at. Watching someone slowly die from it is like watching someone die of leprosy. Brian gave his life so you could see the miracle that is cannabis oil. Others have given their lives as well. But because of their sacrifice, many more will live, because the truth will be fully known. It was Brian who gave me my first ISO-2, one of the devices that I used to make cannabis oil. It was manufactured in 1978. It's actually the gold one you see in the picture here. He found it in a garage being used as an ashtray. Remarkably, it still worked. Brian used his to keep himself alive for several years before conventional medicine finally killed him. He told me that he was passing it on to me after his death so that I could, in his words, make oil and save lives. So I did. Well, I couldn't make oil in Missouri. ISO-2s are illegal here in Missouri. A Missouri lawmaker saw fit to make it a crime punishable by imprisonment just to own one. So now I save Missouri lives in Colorado. I have 2 ISOs now. In the past year, I have given away well over $75,000 worth of cannabis oil to the poor and the needy, made with these 2 simple machines. Little Nova Lee was only 2 when I first heard of her plight. Her young parents did not have much, living in Austin, Texas. They were ill-prepared to have a child with a condition like schizencephaly. Little Nova has only 24% of her brain and a non-functioning pituitary. Seizures began not long after her birth. Controlling her seizures quickly became impossible in conventional terms. Specialists came up with only 2 options down there, a drug that caused permanent blindness. Their defense was schizencephaly patients have questionable degrees of blindness due to narrowed optic nerves, so they considered blindness to be acceptable. Their other option was to remove 2/3 of her cleft brain, without any promise that the procedure would impact her seizures and knowing full well that it probably would kill her. This young couple opted to place most of their earthly possessions at a dumpster and loading into the car mostly what was required to care for their disabled child and headed for Colorado. They had no idea how they were going to get medicine for little Nova or even how they were going to live. I was in touch with them almost from the moment that their journey began. Days later, Barbara, the mother, arrived at our home. Regina, my partner, prepared a pediatric regimen of cannabis oil, roughly 1 gram of pico or full extract cannabis oil per ounce of high-grade olive oil. The mom took it back with her and drew up a dose and placed it in Nova's feeding tube. Almost immediately, Nova Lee's seizures stopped. What emerged in the weeks and months to come is in all reality the rebirth of this child. Not only did Nova Lee's seizures continue to diminish, she's now 99% seizure-free. In just a few days from her first dose, her eyes, which once wandered about independently, became fixed on her parents' faces. She reached out with both hands and grasped her father's beard. Nova began to mimic sounds from her mother and standing up with her father's help. So many things that were thought impossible back when she was almost constantly in seizure. Just a few months ago, Barbara heard her daughter say mama for the very first time. Most recently, Nova's doctors were amazed that now, not only is she thriving, but somehow she's producing growth hormone. Her non-functioning pituitary is now working. These are the wondrous side effects of cannabis. The specialist in Austin told Novalee's parents that it was impossible for cannabis oil to help her seizures. They're still scratching their heads. But her new neurologist in Denver is quite curious because he's seen more and more of these cases. Miracles, really. Noble lives because of THC-rich cannabis oil. Gage is 10 years old. He's a refugee from Missouri. A month before his mom and dad packed up their family and moved to Colorado, Gage was on life support. He was dying. A grand mal seizure, as it is for many, can be lethal. It nearly claimed his young life. Seizures completely altered not only Gage's life, but that of his whole family. He couldn't live like a normal life. He couldn't go to school or play like other kids. Who would have thought that something as simple as a pediatric dose of cannabis oil could make such a difference? Today, less than a year later, Gage looks and acts like any 10-year-old boy. The only difference, he receives a small pediatric dose of cannabis oil, a dose that his school nurse calls incredible and therapeutically dosed due to his seizure control and increased performance in school. He's doing quite well. He looks forward to school and, unlike any kid I have ever known, looks forward to the summer. It was a costly thing that Gage's mother and father had to do. Not every family with a special needs child is as fortunate, uprooting themselves and settling in an unfamiliar and distant place, leaving behind their support system, their family, and their friends. Now a healthier young man, Gage's only regret is that the treatment, his treatment, binds him to the boundaries of Colorado and convicts him of being a criminal in Missouri, solely on the basis of his life-saving treatment. He misses his cousins and grandparents, but when asked at school what he wants to do when he grows up, he has an interesting answer. He said, "I want to make cannabis oil with other kids that well like me." Gage thrives on THC-rich cannabis oil, too. Over the last 8 years, I have met and interviewed many people. I have over 200 of my video interviews on YouTube. City councilmen, mayors, governors, nurses, scientists, but mostly patients. So many illnesses can be impacted by cannabis. After all, it supplements a system we already have in our bodies that touches virtually every facet of our being. What a perfect way to heal. Science has overwhelmingly proven that cannabis is non-toxic. In fact, science says cannabis is food. It has been food for humanity for thousands of years, a superfood, more nutritious than flax. That's really what gives me the authority to make cannabis oil for the sick and the dying. It's food. In fact, there are at least three children who would not be with us today if it were not for my oil. Cannabis oil, THC-rich, full extract cannabis oil, concentrated food. As Hippocrates once said so long ago, let your food be your medicine, and your medicine be your food. You know, I didn't get involved in making cannabis oil because I was looking to supply oil to the unfortunate and terminally ill. That would be a noble calling I just didn't think of. Now, I started making oil because I wanted to know how, so I could teach other people. I was fortunate to learn the simplest and the safest ways first. As Regina later confirmed while presenting at a clinical conference in Italy last year, my method is also the way scientists around the world ensure that they are producing the best array of cannabinoids and terpenes, etc. It was during my learning curve that the patients began to come. And oh, how they came. The cancer patients, the seizure patients, the refugees, the terrified parents without options, and of course the children. Though there were many from within the borders of Colorado, refugees poured in from literally all over the nation, and they're still coming. We have potluck dinners at our home. Many times we have filled our apartment with refugees from states like Texas, Illinois, Georgia, Nebraska, North Carolina, and most certainly Missouri. But I know that these are only the lucky ones, the ones who could afford to come. Many thousands remain in non-lethal states, watching their loved ones struggle just to hold on to life. because they don't have the means to move or the way to purchase the costly but life-saving oil on the black market. What a terrible thing it is to know that your loved ones will continue to suffer and eventually die, not because there is not a treatment, but because of geography. Hope should not be ruled by zip code. But even in Colorado, as much as 90% of those who need cannabis don't have access. It's cost prohibitive. Colorado still has a thriving black market because of the strict regulations, the taxes, and greed. Cannabis is less expensive and more readily available on the black market than in dispensaries. What's more, most dispensaries don't stock FICO, full extract cannabis oil like I make. It's not a hot seller on the recreational market. It doesn't taste good when you smoke it. When you do find it, there's always the question of how it's made, what solvents remain, as well as other contaminants that could harm a fragile life. And of course, the expense. When the proponents of Amendment 64 were touting their recreational bill to the public, they failed to address their underlying intentions. We're seeing them now. Hidden among the ever-growing mounds of regulation, all geared around promoting recreational use and funneling revenue through the dispensary model, while covertly restricting, with the hope of eventually eliminating, home cultivation, caregivers, independent growers, and oil makers like me. Who cares if it costs the lives of the poor and the terminally ill? Cannabis reform is about economic growth, tax dollars. If people want to smoke pot, let's make money off of it. As one popular activist once said, we don't care. Tax the hell out of it. A few months ago, a good friend, a Parkinson's patient whom I have known and counseled for a number of years, passed away in Kansas City. He had been battling his illness for a number of years. He had tried every conventional and homeopathic treatment he could find. At one point, against my warnings, he actually spent $11,000 for questionable cannabis oil that he found on the internet. He was desperate. I could have provided his oil at a fraction of that if he would come to Colorado, but he chose not to. Remarkably, though, he did have significant improvement. But he didn't follow a maintenance dose as I would have instructed. It was too costly, and the risk of arrest was just too great for a 70-plus-year-old. I wrote the Missouri Cannabis Restoration and Protection Act about a year ago. I did so to fulfill a promise that I had made to the citizens of Missouri that I would write a bill that they really wanted. Not another compromise, but what the people truly wanted, real legalization. I knew what the people of Missouri wanted because I asked them in many meetings that I've held throughout the state. The farmers told me that they were desperately in need of help. Industrial hemp could once again be a major cash crop for Missouri, not in these wait-and-see research programs that you've seen pop up all over the country, but a real hemp industry, like the one we once had, but with 21st century technology. Big agriculture equipment companies like John Deere, well, they're ready for us. They're already producing the tools for harvesting hemp in Europe and Canada. Did you know that cannabis paper, just paper, is a $200 billion a year industry in China? Just paper. With a wide array of products that can be made from hemp, it's not hard to realize that in a legal and free market, cannabis represents a $1 trillion a year industry to the Midwest, putting so many people to work and helping so many. As long as cannabis remains on the controlled substance list, it can never truly be legal. That's why the very first line of the Missouri Cannabis Restoration Protection Act removes cannabis entirely from Missouri's list of controlled substances. No non-toxic substance belongs on this list. Removing cannabis from the controlled substance list means that it can be properly classified as a food. Over 6,000 years of being nutrition and medicine for the human race, it should be again. This is how we end prohibition and spark a new beginning with truth. No longer hanging on to falsehoods, hypocrisy, and government propaganda. If we hope to undo this terrible social wrong, then we must in fact undo it. not continue to prohibit it in thinly veiled public policies. Every public policy that has been drafted or endorsed by any of the leading cannabis advocacy organizations has not only failed to reverse prohibition, but in fact endorsed it. Sin-based public policy. It's easier to tax the hell out of it if you think consuming it is somehow harmful, sinful. But consuming cannabis is not a sin, not if you examine the evidence, and not worthy of an excise tax either, a sin tax. It's for that reason that my partner Regina Nelson endorses policy that is based on evidence. Evidence like the real people I'm discussing here. Evidence-based public policy. Why would any cannabis advocacy organization endorse the use of DUI against those who brag to represent? Cannabis is food. Your liver sees it as such and passes it through to be stored in your fat cells. That's why cannabis users can test positive days, even weeks, after using it. Long after the euphoria subsided, alcohol and prescription drugs are held in the liver as it struggles to convert them to a non-toxic substance and then expel them as quickly as possible. For that reason, heroin and cocaine addicts have little fear of the drug test. To date, no scientific evidence can link blood and urine tests to impairment. Those who don't want you to read my bill say that it lets anyone drive stone. Actually, what it really says, the use and or possession of cannabis shall not be grounds for issuing a driving under influence, a DUI, charge, arrest, or fines when operating a motor vehicle. Basically, you have to be committing an actual crime. You can't be ticketed or arrested because you use cannabis or for looking like someone who does, or because your car would fetch a good price if claimed by asset forfeiture. Profiling is bigotry, not police work. You know, it's encouraging. I've received thank yous and well wishes from literally around the world since drafting my bill. But I've received criticism too. Statements saying that an 8-year-old could walk into a store and buy a bag of weed. That got me thinking. So I headed down to the local dollar store to take a look around. What I found was not unlike any department store, grocery store, or convenience mart I have ever been anywhere in the nation. As you can see by this picture was taken at an 8-year-old's height. There, at an 8-year-old's height, were cold medicines, birth control, pain, remedies, and at the end of the aisle, bleach. Around the corner, mice and rat poison. A child would not even have to leave the store to become contaminated, to be poisoned. After a careful review of virtually every food item, it was easy to surmise that cannabis would in fact be the safest thing for an 8-year-old to take out of the store. So really what the discussion had to do with wasn't toxicity, but euphoria. Science has proven overwhelmingly that cannabis does not cause brain damage, but actually instills neuroprotection, and that unlike pharmaceuticals and alcohol, is actually good for the body and brain. So the powers that be and the National Cannabis Advocacy Organization that has criticized this bill, in reality, has an issue with euphoria. My answer to that is actually found in the question, why, with so many toxins within reach, why are not more of our children poisoned? I know very few cleanser and medicine cabinets across the country that bear a padlock. Two simple phrases, parental guidance when you're a child, and personal accountability when you're grown. Or as the Bible states, and I paraphrase, train up your child in the way he should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it. Now, particularly in regard to euphoria, if you have personal and or religious feelings against the experience of euphoria, and feel strongly against your child experiencing it, it's actually your job as a parent to instruct them so. It is not the job of law enforcement or the court system to enforce your personal beliefs. Little Isaiah wasn't quite 3 years old when his young refugee parents brought him to Colorado for treatment. They were Nebraska natives. They had exhausted every conventional means to control their young Isaiah's seizures. For most of his short life, He had experienced an array of different kinds. When Isaiah was 6 months old, a family member with the herpes simplex virus kissed him on the mouth. Encephalitis quickly developed. His brain swelling, seizures soon gripped his tiny body. Genital herpes is a disease caused by the herpes simplex virus, of which there are two types. Type 1 usually causes oral herpes, an infection of the lips and mouth. Symptoms are commonly known as cold sores or fever blisters, while most cases of genital herpes is caused by type 2. What followed for little Isaiah was a procession of dangerous pharmaceutical drugs like Lamictal. Lamictal is a drug prescribed for bipolar disorder, but off-label for 2 to 16-year-olds with intractable seizures. Isaiah began an adult dose at the age of 7 months. Though many drugs were tried, nothing seemed to hamper the ever-growing severity and number of seizures. Sudden drop seizures soon required that Isaiah wear a helmet. The parents knew they had to do something, anything, to stop their child's seizures. Cannabis was literally their last hope. Entering our home, it was all the young father could do to carry their flailing son into our living room and sit down. Isaiah was in seizure. After discussing the treatment, Rusia, Isaiah's mother, asked if she could administer a pediatric dose sublingually. With poor Isaiah flopping his head from side to side, it was difficult, but Mom pressed in with a needleless syringe and deposited the suspension between the teeth and gum. 3 minutes passed as I observed Isaiah, his eyes rolling about, his arms and head flailing, a near constant experience at this point. But suddenly, he stopped. Isaiah seemed to wake up. Intently, he scanned the room. When his father spoke, Isaiah slowly and very matter-of-factly rotated on his father's lap and gazed into his father's eyes. Surprised, his father stated, "He's never acknowledged me like that before." It had been over 2 years since he had looked into his parents' eyes because of the constant seizures and the terrible drugs he was prescribed. This was life-changing. In the months since, Isaiah has continued to grow, exploring a life that is virtually seizure-free, and as importantly, free of the toxic pharmaceuticals that cause so much harm to his tiny body. He now follows his mom around the house, shouting, "Mommy!" He laughs and plays. He's learning and he's growing. Isaiah takes a THC-rich cannabis oil, along with an oil that is rich in CBD, to mitigate the withdrawal from pharmaceutical drugs. For her first 6 months, Andrea's life was pretty much that of any healthy young infant. Then the unthinkable. As it was with Isaiah, a family member innocently kissed Andrea's lips, started the same horrific chain of events. Only difference was this was 13 years ago. The only option Andrea's parents had was conventional treatment and a seemingly endless procession of pharmaceuticals. Andrea had little defense against the crippling disease, rendering significant brain damage, both from the encephalitis and the toxic pharmaceuticals. Terrible seizures began with puberty and continue to this day. Andrea is now 25 years old. Scott and his wife take turns sleeping in Andrea's room so they can watch over her at night, a ritual that has not been interrupted for now over 13 years. Andrea currently takes more than a dozen pharmaceuticals. Recently, doctors have recommended a VNS implant, which her parents are considering because they have few other choices where they live there in Oklahoma. They know that AEDs are harming her. They are largely ineffective and causing aggressive behavior. She's been on many of them for many years, costing Scott's insurance company nearly $8,000 a month. A non-invasive treatment like cannabis is not possible for Andrea, though her parents are willing. Unfortunately, all the doctors offer to her is for the surgery. Andrea's never had the opportunity to develop. Her cognitive skills are significantly underdeveloped. Unlike Isaiah, who is now flourishing and will someday catch up to his age group, Andrea has little hope. Not in conventional terms, anyway. But what if things would have been different? What if? In Kansas, there's a little girl by the name of Autumn. A beautiful little redhead doll, so full of life. At 3 months, Autumn started having seizures too. After months of EEGs, MRIs, CAT scans, and a lumbar puncture, a genetics test told Autumn's parents that she had a genetic mutation called sodium channelopathy, or SCNI1. SCN1 is the cause of her refractory epilepsy, and it's what has made her prone to prolonged amphibial seizures. Autumn seizures are brought on by triggers, such as a rise in body temperature, or being too upset, or excited, or being fatigued. However, she has also been known to have seizures without any triggers at all. She has never come out of a seizure on her own. She always needs to be assisted with medication. This also makes her unable to use the anti-epileptic drugs that affect sodium channels as they intensify her seizures. The few pharmaceuticals available to her have not been able to control her seizures. They do, however, give her side effects like irritability, loss of appetite, insomnia, damage to organs, and decaying teeth. They can also cause her to go into respiratory arrest. On the average, Autumn and her parents are in the ICU 34 times a month. On a regular basis, Autumn is put on life support. Autumn's neurologist told her parents that she's exhausted all of her options. Her pediatrician wants her to have the opportunity to use cannabis oil. Unfortunately, cannabis is still illegal in Kansas. Her parents would risk losing Autumn to Child Protective Services if they were to give her even one pediatric dose. In fact, in her state, they would rather see her perish than have cannabis oil. Different paths lay out for Autumn's parents. Her mother, Christine, knows of Isaiah and his story, but relocating is not an option, not yet. Truly, healing shouldn't know any boundaries. The rest of the nation's children suffer the same illnesses and afflictions as Missouri, Nebraska, Oklahoma, Kansas, and Texas children do. I know, I have made oil for children who are refugees from all of these places and many more. How can we deny these, our most vulnerable, and knowing that it is safe, even those whose lives hang by a thread? Why do we jail our adults for appreciating its benefits? The blinders of prohibition have the roots in ignorance. Only way to end either is with education, with truth. The truth is there. I live with it daily. The miracles, they accompany us perpetually. As for America's chronically and terminally ill, they shouldn't have to leave their home, their state, to appreciate these things, to save the life of a loved one. All families should have the assurance of a safe, holistic choice apart from harmful, dangerous pharmaceuticals. It's time to put away the hypocrisy and accept the truth we know about cannabis. Cannabis is non-toxic. Cannabis is food. Cannabis is the single most important medicine of the 21st century, and America deserves the healing that it can bring. Supporting real initiatives like the Missouri Cannabis Restoration and Protection Act begins to undo the social wrongdoing that began in the 30s and continues to this day. It avoids entanglements of prohibitionist profiteers, cartels, and the black market. Instead, it treats cannabis as a public health issue, which it is. The Missouri Cannabis Restoration Protection Act is evidence-based public policy. The evidence, the living evidence, speaks for itself. We can't afford to listen, not to listen. Thank you. Questions? Any questions?
I have a question about the ballot initiative. How many 166,000.
166, are they broken up into districts?
Yes.
How many per district?
We have to, well, it depends upon the district. What it is, it's all calculated by the last general election.
Uh-huh.
And what they do is they take a percentage of that number, and that's how they calculate how many signatures. And so it's different per district according to how many people actually voted.
Okay.
Because that's really what it's based on.
I see. So it's not based on population, it's based on...
number of votes.
Well, those districts are supposed to be roughly equally populated. I mean, we're talking about in the ballpark between 26,000 to 28,000 per congressional district.
We have to take 7 out of 8, is what it comes down to. We, in other words, we have, if it calls for 26,000, we have to have 26,000 there. We can't have 25,999.
Gotcha. As, are you trying to get this on 2016 ballot?
Yes.
So you need 166,000 broken up into like 5 districts?
Let me make one thing really clear. Okay, I wrote this.
Uh-huh.
Now I am a Colorado resident, so all I can do here is, again, provide education and help you all to take and make a decision for yourselves.
You know?
I wish I could be here, but quite honestly, I can't be here any longer because for my own health's sake, I have to be there. So
I'm working on the same thing in Mississippi.
Mississippi.
So I'm curious about, you know, what's going on because I'm from Missouri.
Absolutely. Currently, right now, California is looking at my at the language of my bill, as well as Nevada, Arizona, Oklahoma. Well, I'm going to be working in Illinois very soon, so I assure you Illinois will be too. Louisiana has actually taken the language of my bill and put it into a House bill. Causing a bit of stir down there right now. So it's interesting, you know. But that's the fact, is that healing is something that extends to everyone. And when you see the life of a child in particular, it's very important. I have been accused, they said, oh, you're taking and using these kids. You're using their image. The truth be known, the parents have urged me. They have begged me. They said, use my image. Look, Gage's a mom. She would love to be here right now. But she can't be without endangering her safety and the safety of her child. It was my hope and my goal that by this time I would have been able to bring them in via Skype, because I would love to introduce them all to you via live, you know. So you can see these are real people. They're not fake. They're not something pulled out of a magazine or a newspaper or something. These are real people. I'm nothing special because I make cannabis oil. It's not that hard. If you can make a roux or a gravy, you can make cannabis oil. It's a food. It is a food. Cannabis is non-toxic. When you consume cannabis oil, it fortifies a system you already have within your body. Your own endocannabinoid system. Every mammal has one. Pretty cool thing. Other questions? Yes?
What are the side effects?
Side effects. The worst one is getting arrested. Quite literally. Yeah. Quite literally. Now, let's talk about side effects, okay?
Yeah.
We have side effects. It's understandable. The one that you see the most, you hear the most, is euphoria. And that's why I really wanted to touch on euphoria. It's transient. It doesn't last very long, the euphoria. But if you're a cancer patient, it can be significant because you need to take a very high dose, a concentrator or a concentrate like cannabis oil to shrink cannabis tumors and all. So you're going to experience some euphoria from it because you'll hear a lot about CBD, and that there's no euphoria. Well, there's issues with CBD too, because there is actually an entourage effect that takes place with cannabis, with the individual cannabinoids found within cannabis. When you take one of them out, the effectiveness drops substantially. I can say this because I make both THC and CBD oil. So if you've got questions about CBD in particular, ask me about those too. But back to the euphoria. Again, it's very transient. And for those people who are just starting using it and it's an issue with them, there are different things that we can do to help offset that. Like we mentioned CBD, or the one component called CBD. We can actually administer some more CBD in a little higher range, and what it does, it helps to mitigate much of the high. We can also talk about a choline supplement. Choline actually supplements. When you use cannabis and you experience euphoria, your natural acetylcholine levels drop. And they believe that that could possibly have somewhat to do with this effect, which is totally does not cause any harm to the body whatsoever. So we talk about administering choline, which is a natural supplement. You can get it at a health food store. You take choline, it causes your body to produce more acetylcholine, which mitigates much of the high, which makes it much more tolerable. The one biggest factor in it is the longer you take cannabis, the more your body adjusts to it, the less high you experience it. I have been a patient for over 18 years. I've been using cannabis. I don't get high. I feel better. I get the good part, and I'm really satisfied with that. Now, for people like myself who have post-traumatic stress, I spend a lot of time talking to veterans who deal with that. I have interviewed on camera veterans from the Vietnam conflict, through the Gulf War, through Iraq, Afghanistan. I have many veterans who are very close personal friends of mine. The euphoria can be a release and can be a really good thing. One particular cannabinoid found is called CBN, which is another one that you'll hear more about in the future. CBN has been found to be particularly beneficial for anxiety. Understand, we lose, the VA says 22 veterans a day. The number, in my opinion, is closer to 24 to 26 veterans every day. A lot of the veterans I speak to say that the people they came back with, most of them are gone. It's not a question of if veterans, or I should say those suffer post-traumatic stress, are going to commit suicide, but rather when. I personally believe that there's three things, I'm sorry I'm digressing from what you said. There are three things that I believe are crucial for our veterans, but more importantly for everyone, because it's not just veterans who suffer from post-traumatic stress, but individuals who've had anxiety from a car accident or from a long, prolonged period of being sick. You know, there's a lot of different reasons why we suffer post-traumatic stress. It's kind of like a broken record. It's a loop that you keep coming back to over and over again. It's so intense. But there are three things I believe that are really crucial for those who suffer post-traumatic stress. And the first, by and far, is cannabis. By and far, there is nothing that treats anxiety better than cannabis. The second is counseling. Every veteran, every person who suffers post-traumatic stress needs to talk and needs to be able to express themselves and be counseled. The third thing is service. Our veterans are basically broken down and turned into a tool. All veterans can relate to this. You are basically fashioned for a job. Then you're abused, like an abused tool, and then cast away, cast to the side. There's no worse thing you can do to a tool than to take away its purpose. So they need to be repurposed. And that's the other thing I hope to be able to do with veterans in the time to come. Some of my veterans already are getting purpose because they're working with me and they're working with some of the work that I'm doing, making coil and talking with patients. Some of my veterans are helping people with cultivation, helping them get up and start and different things like that. Something to do, something to put their hands to, something positive to bring out on this. That really, the euphoria is transient. That's really the only side effect that we've found from. Cannabis is highly nutritious, so that after you get past the euphoria, people usually find that they have a much better quality of life. Cannabis, when you're treating pain, doesn't cover up the pain like painkillers do. It actually allows you to distance yourself from the pain to be able to deal with it. It's the same way with emotional issues like post-traumatic stress. The ability to be able to push that back away where you can take and deal with it now. It's not the central, most important factor in your life. Yes?
Yeah, pharmaceuticals has been worse for me than any.
Oh my goodness.
Yes.
I had people tell me after I started working with children, they said, oh my God, you are getting those children stoned. Now you understand these pictures of the children you see up here, many of them like Isaiah have open prescriptions for Oxycontin and hydrocodone, younger than the age of two. These kids were stoned before they ever saw me. They were stoned terribly. They were basically vegetables, non-functional. They had no personality. All they did was sit and stare. You know. Then once we started getting them off the prescription drugs and using cannabis, suddenly this personality started coming out. You know, we thought a couple of these kids, we thought they were autistic because of their behavior. It was the pharmaceuticals. Once the pharmaceuticals were gone, there was a baby, you know. It's pretty cool.
Other questions? Yes?
How's your work on cirrhosis of the liver?
Amazingly. Actually, you have CD2 receptors found in your gut and in your liver. Mm-hmm. So you have, it's cannabis again, it's nutrition, it's healing to the whole body. The liver is a surprisingly rejuvenative organ. I've interviewed patients with hepatitis C. One I'm thinking about in Michigan, he had been diagnosed with hepatitis C ever since leaving Vietnam. After being on cannabis oil for 70 years, he no longer tests positive for it anymore. His wife had lupus, butterfly lupus. She broke down across her face this way. She no longer tests positive for lupus. Both of those things are supposed to be medical impossibility. But I'm sorry, I've seen it.
Well, I was diagnosed in 2012. They labeled me as cirrhosis of the liver. Never did drugs, never drank. So I asked, I was told it was bullshit when I woke up. But they never did a biopsy on my liver to actually put it there. So.
Quite often pharmaceuticals can be at the root of
I refused from day one to take any of their medicine, and they said I should have been dead. And so I've been smoking cannabis, medical cannabis, and I can actually feel the inflammation go down.
Cannabis is an anti-inflammatory.
Yeah, it just shrinks it right down. I sleep better. I have wonderful dreams, but I'm on cannabis oil, and I can't get it.
Yeah, that's the thing. When you talk about euphoria, pharmaceuticals, virtually every pharmaceutical, look at the side effects. You'll find euphoria is on there. Okay? Nightmares quite often is on there. I don't hear of anyone having nightmares on cannabis. The people don't go around stoned. It's people who are patients, they are healthy. You know, I mean, I had one parent, they were talking, you know, so they were kind of worried because they had never seen their child laugh before. They got kind of worried about that. You know, they said, he's happy, he plays now all the time, he's scaring us. Yeah, I had the same reaction. Yeah.
I had my left kidney removed because I had cancer there, and my right one is only partially functional.
Well, you know, your kidney and your liver, you know, these are all our filters. Exactly. These are our filters, you know, and that's really important. You know. But yes, absolutely. You know, what we see is we're seeing the most remarkable things. The reason we're seeing the most remarkable things is because cannabis is more available now than it ever has before. Even though it's really highly restricted, even in states like Colorado, and even though we see research still being rather spotty, it is still... we're seeing miracles because it's more available and because of higher concentrations being accessible.
Yes. So will you leave some information for us to contact you and get more to get involved?
Absolutely. Everyone here, anyone who needs it would like a business card, please grab one from me. I have some in a box or someplace I can take and give some more out.
How does it work with addiction?
Remarkably well. Remarkably well. That's what we have found CBD in particular is really good at. The one cannabinoid CBD, again, it has a entourage effect working with other cannabinoids, but we're finding that it really helps well with our children helping get them off of it. Prescription drugs.
Yeah.
It's interesting. I had a guy in North Carolina tell me once at AA that cannabis was the one unspoken treatment for alcoholism and drug addiction.
And pharmaceutical that gets you off of their side effects and addiction.
Yeah, getting away from those. Yeah. It's
the bring your sex life back to you.
Yeah, as a matter of fact, they'll do that as well. And that's a whole other issue I'm happy to touch on sometime.
Well, my wife was wondering when they bring my sex life back.
It can.
Okay.
Yes, it can. I'm sorry? That's another side effect. That's exactly right, another side effect.
I have a question.
Yes.
How about being able to make an oil for can of butter or whatnot? How do you can tell what the THC content is in can of butter and then also dosage?
That's kind of all over the place, as you can imagine with any food, okay? It's like using a very generalized statement regarding food overall. There, I often say cannabis is variations on the good. And the reason I say that is even if you do a poor quality job of preparing it, it's still medicine. And that's really important to know. Like, okay, case in point, whenever you make butter or you make oil, if you heat it too hot, when I make oil, I'm talking temperatures are roughly around 200 degrees and not any hotter than that. If you scorch it, you convert it to another substance from THC to CBN. Now, CBN is still medicine. That's why I say variations on the good. But CBN is particularly beneficial, again, like I said earlier, for the treatment of anxiety. Maybe not so much for cancer. So we want to preserve the THC as much as possible and not run it converted into another substance. So it's important that when you cook it, whether you're talking in water like you're talking, one part way of extracting it, or in a concentrate like oil, we keep the temperature down really low and we cook it until we process. Basically, when I make oil, I use alcohol or Everclear, food grade alcohol.
To make it.
I'm sorry?
Like the Rick Simpson?
Not exactly. Rick Simpson's process, there is this process that predates Rick Simpson, which is hemp oil, basically hemp oil, which has been made for eons. Rick Simpson actually has used two different processes. He's used one called naphtha, which is a very dirty solvent. I don't recommend it to anyone. He's also talked about using butane. You'll hear a lot of late about butane extraction, which people blow themselves up with it. Because of people with lack of education taking and attempting to do something that people, only people who have an education on how to do. I don't do butane extractions personally, just because butane, actually, more so the blowing agent, and it's called pentane more so, can be residuals in the oil. Okay, and to me, I would rather talk and promote a way in which to take and produce it that would be the least volatile, that's going to be the easiest to use, and that even if you mess it up and you consume some of the alcohol, it's still food grade.
It's food, so you don't want to mess it up, you season to taste. Is that right?
Well, actually, my oil has been tested by the Denver Children's Hospital, and they found zero alcohol in mine. If you're conscientious about the way in which you make oil or whatever the product is, you don't have to worry about things like that.
Well, it's like food alcohol cooked out, right?
It does. And it's the least as far as something being explosive. People say, actually, it was through me that you'll hear about that law they're passing all over the country right now. They're saying recently in the state of Colorado that they said that no longer going to be oil production at home. That's not correct. They called me and asked me for my opinion on it, and I submitted a report talking about alcohol production, so they made an exemption in that report. The only thing is, they're not talking about my exemption, and they're talking to everyone. They're just blatantly saying that everyone can't produce it. It's not true. Yeah.
I've had a problem talking
Pharmaceutical companies want cannabis in a really bad way right now. About 6 months ago, I had an Israeli pharmaceutical company took me out for a really nice dinner. And they were pushing their little pills. Basically, for the last 15 years, the pharmaceutical industry basically has had an open ability to test and work with cannabis. Don't believe the lies. Cannabis has been tested a zillion times. It is literally the most tested medicine known to man.
They have a lab in Mississippi. They've had it since 1960-something. 1970s, and they've been growing, legally growing and experimenting and studying cannabis in the state of Mississippi since the 70s.
That's what you're referring to is the Compassionate Investigation and Drug Program. Guys, I can do this all day and all night. I know there are currently four surviving members of that program. They're all personal friends of mine. Actually, George McMahon, who lives in Iowa, is one of my mentors. He's like my big brother. The thing is that two of them are no longer on the program purely because their doctor retired. And so after 20 slide years, they no longer have access to their medicine. It's a real poor quality cannabis, really poor quality. It's given to them, I should have brought one. It's shipped to them in a tin that's roughly about this big round, and it holds 300 oversized joints.
Wow.
Or cigarettes. It's rolled by a regular cigarette rolling machine. They're very old, and I used to be able to tell you what the brand was on the machine. But it's a University of Mississippi, very good. University of Mississippi. It was a guy by the name of William Randall who was patient number one in that program. And then it kind of stemmed from that. He sued the federal government and started the thing rolling. The program, it expanded out to be like 15 patients were on the list at one point. And then in 1991, I believe it was, George Bush Sr. shut down the program because too many people with AIDS and HIV were trying to get on the program. And he couldn't handle people with AIDS and getting that kind of treatment.
So the Laredo is a cigarette rolling machine.
I'm sorry?
The cigarette rolling machine, Laredo is a cigarette
rolling. I can't remember now. I just can't remember it. But it's something else. Like I said, the cannabis was very poor quality. And the federal government refused to receive any of the data that was collected on it. The patients actually pooled themselves together, and it was called, I'll tell you in a second here what the name of the study was called, but they formed their own study, and out of their own pocket, paid for all of the testing and everything on themselves and stuff. The federal government still turned a blind eye to it. The whole, it was all of this was all done by and large to unite us, so they really were looking to try to find harm or something bad. Since they didn't find it, they didn't want to have anything to do with it. So it's the survivors are George McMahon and Barb Douglas, who are in Iowa, Ellen Masika, who has glaucoma. Oh, by the way, Barb Douglas has MS. George has nail patella syndrome, and we have Irv Rosenthal down in Florida, who he has an illness. Well, I can't even tell you the name of it, but he develops really cysts on his bones, and they tear at the flesh. It's really, really tough. But he's a stockbroker down there. I mean, very intelligent job. People trust him with a lot of their money. And he's a pretty smart guy. Anyway, you hear about all these CBD programs? They're basically glorified IND programs. That's the only way that you can take and utilize a Schedule I drug. You have to have access to a Schedule I physician and a Schedule I pharmacy. If you don't, you can't be a part of that.
Tell them where to find your YouTube channel.
Oh, YouTube channel? Well, I got a couple. Actually, we have one is my ECS therapy, which .org, which is one of ours. We also have cpninstitute.org, which for my other CPN Institute is becoming our benevolence org. Also, too, you can go to cannabispatientnetwork.org and see over 200 of my interviews there as well. Virtually every form of illness I've covered. I have like about 20 more interviews waiting to go in there. I've got some series I'm working on where veterans as well as the children. I'm going to be working on a television series coming up in the coming months, later on this year as well. I'll be opening up centers in Oklahoma, in Old Colorado State, which is adjacent to Colorado Springs, as well as in Peoria, Illinois. We will be working in Illinois.
Wow. Where's the TV series?
I'm sorry?
Where is the TV series?
It's going to be on a cable network, and I can't tell you at this present moment, but I've been blessed to have some people who really want to get this information.
That's awesome. Yeah.
And we need to be talking about this.
My daughter is 8. She has autism and epilepsy, and we've been looking online at like CBD and different things to try and control her seizures. She has micro seizures, and she takes a heavy dose of Depakote to deal with those. Do you think cannabis oil would be a treatment that might help her?
Absolutely. Now, one thing I will tell you, and like I said, you're going to hear a lot about CBD, and that CBD, people think that, CBD, they don't have to deal with euphoria, so it'll be safe for our children. Well, CBD, even though it was on CNN with the Shantae Gupta thing and all that, the thing that they didn't take into consideration is the CBD is only particularly beneficial for Dravet syndrome, only one form of seizures. Other forms of seizures, not so much. The children who were spotlighted in the CNN episode were getting benefits like 35%, 45%. I believe that Charlotte Figge, the one who Charlotte's Web, was named after the strain Charlotte's Web. receive somewhere in the neighborhood of about 65% relief from seizures. The problem is they continue to elevate the levels of CBD higher artificially, create something that's really, really high in CBD. What we find is diminishing results as we do that. In fact, you get to a point where the CBD starts causing seizures. So what we do is we treat with THC-rich cannabis oil, and children adjust to the side effects, the euphoria, the other issues, much more quickly than adults do. They don't, most likely because adults just have fear because of all the propaganda and all the rest. So they come into it, they're already afraid of pharmaceuticals because they've already, anyone who's been chronically ill, you know what I'm talking about. I see heads shaking. I don't probably have to say, you know, there's some terrible things you deal with if you've been on pharmaceuticals, or kids get too. My partner, Regina Nelson, I talked about her daughter coming moving out with us. I have a special needs child. Little Shane, he stands about this tall, little bitty guy like that. He spent most of his life in hospitals, okay? So when he sees someone in scrubs, he screams. He gets mad. His face gets red, and he tries to get away any way possible. He was in the hospital a number of months ago and was awakened in the middle of the night by a nurse who had no business messing with him, but did. And when he jumped up, accidentally ripped his feeding tube out of his belly. He had to have emergency surgery. When he came home, I was in the hospital at the same time because I had to have kidney surgery. He came home first. My partner, Regina, she was in the kitchen preparing a pediatric regimen for another patient, little Miles, who has another Yankee syndrome. And she had already made it and was setting out on the tables, 8 ounce container, jar. You know, like I said, 8 ounces, so it had 8 grams in there, suspended, sitting on the table. Little Shane comes walking in, and he's mad. 3 years old, I mean, little bitty guy, little man. He comes walking, he saw that up in the chair, up on the table, and he points at it and says, I want that. That's my queen medicine. I want that, put it in there now. Just like that. And the dad is sitting back beside him. Give it to him, I don't care. Go ahead, give him a dose, you know? So Regina took out a teaspoon, and this isn't rocket science, it's food. Took out a teaspoon and put some in the teaspoon and gave it to him. He takes it right quick, right down. Again, like I'm going to say, pharmaceuticals, he'd scream, he's running the other way. This, he takes it, he took it quickly. Thank you. Off into the other room to play. He wasn't stoned. He's not stoned. He was, when he was on pharmaceuticals. Now he's healthy. He's thinking. When he first came to us, he was physical therapy to come to our house, and different people working with him and stuff. He tested very poorly when he first came from Michigan, you know. But recently, when they tested him cognitively, he was rated at a second grade level. I mean, he's ready to go to school now, you know. He gets his feeding tube out next week. He hasn't had any food through the feeding tube since he was at least 5 months ago. 5 months. I make the statement I've said before that while there was adequate, after his first dose of my oil, this little boy had taken very little through his mouth. Very little. He didn't even like textures in his mouth. He was ailing. He hadn't even taken food. He had to take it all through too. After the first dose, he comes into his mom who's talking to Regina on the phone and he goes, oh, my dogs. He's never asked for food before that period of time. He goes, I want a hot dog. Didn't even realize he even thought about hot dogs. So she said, okay. She got him a hot dog. Puts it in front of him. He picks it up and eats it like an ear of corn. She's bawling as she's watching this thing taking place. It's like, she's telling Regina, oh. After he finishes the hot dog, pushes himself away from him, says, I'm going to go play with his sister. He never played with his sister. You didn't even know he even thought about that. All he did was lay on the couch and cry before that. He goes in and he's playing with his sister. You know, and it's just like, wow. And watching this kid grow, you know, and continue to grow. Absolutely. Absolutely.
So you would recommend like the full extract cannabis oil, not the CBD or the CBN?
Absolutely. What you're going to see a lot too is you're going to see oil that is THCA oil. Okay, and THCA oil, basically what you have is you'll hear about things like activating the cannabis. Basically, what happens over the course of time cannabis changes, or you can take an artificial positive change. THC acid, or THCA, CBD acid, CBDA, these are precursors. And with heat, or different ways of taking it, you can convert them into the next stage, which would be CBD or THC. THCA is non-psychoactive, THC is, that's the reason behind it. The difference is your body converts it to THC in your liver, it will convert from THC to THCA to THC, so you don't experience the euphoria there. That is okay, that's fine. We find that the reaction is slower, it takes longer, it takes more to get to where you were going to go before. If we're dealing with life-threatening issues, I feel like it's best to go to what could be the benefit immediately. Because again, we're talking about food, we're not talking about any kind of harm.
What kind of a dosage would you recommend for a year-old weighing about 60 pounds?
It, quite literally, again, to variations on it, but there is, cannabis will never fit a pharmaceutical model. So when we talk about dosing, it's ballpark, and it's going to be different for every person. So we say start off low and start adjusting up your dose until you get to that place where you see the benefit. Dealing with cancer is different than dealing with other issues, particularly epilepsy and other things, because you don't need nearly as high a dose. For the child, it's a pediatric dose. For us, what we do is we suspend in olive oil, but you can suspend in other things as well, you know, to break the dose down. You just want to be cognizant of what the amount is. So, you know, whenever you find that point where you're at, you know, you work it. So we strongly recommend journaling. And again, starting off with a small dose. For most, it begins the same. It's 1 gram per 1 ounce of olive oil or honey or whatever product you want to take a mix with. We use olive oil because it seems to be the most neutral. You know, mixing
about coconut oil.
Coconut oil is another. I mentioned honey. Uh-huh. We don't give honey to a child under the age of 3 because there is supposed to be a risk of botulism and we don't want to create any issues for the child. With coconut oil, there is a risk of stomach upset and diarrhea, so you basically have to test and see how it works. Same thing for adults. Okay? So looking for the most neutral thing seems to be the best. We'll even take and we will dose peanut butter because we want, some people say, oh, you're putting that in foods that make it too tempting for a child. Excuse me, the important thing is to heal the child. And if the child can take and consume it easier that way, then more power to that. And it's something that's helpful. Of course, we got to think about peanuts, right? Think about peanuts and allergies there as well, right? That again, that's why we come back to the olive oil. But it depends upon the individual, you know? It really does. Again, you're dosing with food. That's the important issue here. You're trying to raise their cannabinoid levels. This is, in a family setting, that becomes very easy. You cook with it. You use it in your food. You add it to your food. Next to our, I used to be able to say that, I can't really say it right now, but I have a big tall bottle of olive oil that sits next to my stove out in Colorado Springs, and it's cannabis-infused olive oil, and I might add it to my eggs, or I might add it to my spinach, break the spinach. Peanut butter, you have medicated peanut butter, put it on toast, oh, it's awesome. The flavor of the cannabinoids, the cannabis actually accentuates the peanut butter, it makes it even taste even better. You see, that's what I'm saying. You don't have to dose with food, it doesn't have to taste bad. You can eat, you have something that's natural with no side effects that's going to benefit you. You're going to have a better quality of life. And isn't that what it's all about?
Well, what about the schools? We're talking about, my daughter, since she has autism and death. I want to try to cannabis oil with her. But now you got the schools, you got the laws, you got the state.
That's the problem.
I can't give it to her because they won't let.
That's the problem when we're talking about laws like we see all across the country regarding cannabis. As long as it is a harmful, dangerous drug, as long as it's a Schedule 1 drug, you're not going to, if you can't treat it like food, you can't, the people who really need it are not going to have access to it. Most particularly our most vulnerable are those people like our babies, our children. I could tell you reports and stories of most miraculous things that come to our children. If it is safe and effective for treating our most vulnerable, why isn't it safe for you?
did.
Why isn't it safe for our senior citizens, which God need it, which includes me? You know? Guys, I appreciate you guys staying long. Anybody have any more questions? I'll be here as long as you have questions. Any other questions?